Blackstone presents Visible Hand, A Wealth of Notions on the Miracle of the Market by Matthew Hennessey. This book is read by Andrew Fallaize. For my father, who gave me everything. Introduction. I am not an economist. I'm telling you that now, here at the beginning, because you have a right to know what kind of person you're dealing with. This is a book about economics, broadly speaking, and some would say I'm out of my depth. Fair enough. I'm not licensed. I don't have a PhD in economics. I don't have a PhD in anything. The gatekeepers of the vast edifice of economic knowledge tend not to look kindly on the opinions of the uncredentialed. They like to keep it complicated. They prefer to dress economic things up in opaque terminology and technical jargon, stashing it all on a high college shelf, well out of the reach of the average person. This book is not for them. I don't pretend to be making a contribution to the academic literature. This isn't a dissertation or a textbook. It's just one guy's view of the world through market-coloured glasses. Don't say I didn't warn you. There's more you should know. I've never worked in business, banking, finance, or, until relatively recently, a large private company. I couldn't tell you a single useful thing about accounting other than that assets equal liabilities plus equity on the balance sheet, and that people who study accounting in college tend to nab high-paying jobs right out of the gate. I don't know how to read an earnings report, and I'm useless with a spreadsheet. Stocks don't interest me much, apart from the possibility that they will pay for my retirement. Cryptocurrency might as well be professional lacrosse for all I care about it, which is not very much. I don't think the world revolves around career, money, bond prices, or the oil market. After reading a list of all my non-qualifications, you may be wondering why I have written a book on economics at all. I did it because I suspect many people are afraid of economics or confused and intimidated by it, just like I once was. For most of my life, I avoided the topic entirely. Then I woke up one day and realized that all I'd been doing my whole life was acting like an economist, responding to incentives, weighing trade-offs, making decisions at the margin, and calculating the utility of everything from investing in my education to helping myself to a second scoop of strawberry ice cream. So this is a book about economics for people who, broadly speaking, don't like economics, or think they don't. I'm the sort of fellow who thinks American-style capitalism works pretty damn well most of the time, especially when alternatives are considered. It has its quirks, it has its shortcomings, it even has its failures, but free markets have, over the past three centuries, lifted billions of people out of poverty in every corner of the globe. That's not a meaningless statement. Real people, as alive as you or me, who would otherwise have lived solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short lives, instead lived good lives, fruitful lives, healthy lives, prosperous lives, all thanks to the material improvements made possible by free markets. It happened in my own family. My parents grew up poor. My dad was born during the Depression. He wore clothes with holes in them. My mother was born in the mid-1940s. She lived in a house with no indoor plumbing. In later life, my parents managed to push their way solidly into the middle class. As owners of a small local business, they made enough money to allow them to take relaxing vacations. They visited Turks and Caicos. They once went to Hawaii. They visited England, Scotland, and Wales. They traipsed around France. They crisscrossed Ireland, their common ancestral homeland, in search of the source of the jigs and reels that gave rhythm to their hearts. These were the kinds of holidays that their own parents could never have dreamed possible. Eventually, they sold their old, cold house on a busy road and decamped for the tranquility of the New Jersey countryside, such as it is. My mother spent her final years puttering around in a biggish flower garden. My dad loved nothing more than to sit on his spacious and well-shaded deck with a book on his lap as he dozed to the sounds of the forest. Only in America. And only in hindsight can I see how their life's work was accomplished. How they built a good thing in this world. An enterprise, if you like, and sustained it even as it sustained them and a great many people who came into contact with it and with them. My parents owned a business, but they didn't consider themselves business people. Then again, everyone is in business, as legendary Wall Street Journal editor Barney Kilgore liked to say, the business of making a living. My main goal here is to clarify a few things, to make economics, broadly speaking, seem a little less frightening for anyone who does their best to avoid it as a matter of mental and emotional hygiene. I address what might fairly be called the basics: choice, competition, incentives, scarcity, trade-offs, supply and demand, prices, utility, etc. At various times I present my parents' small business as a sort of case study for how a profit-seeking enterprise can provide social goods. And not just a single or limited social good, like generating an income for a family, but a cascade of social goods, like spreading happiness, holding a community together, and increasing the general welfare. In recent years, free markets have come under fire from both left and right. Both criticisms need dealing with, and I will give it a go, but the greater problem across every level of American society is a simpler one: ignorance. Most people don't even know what a market is, much less what makes one free. They shut down when they hear the word capitalism or economics. They tune out. They start thinking about what's for dinner or humming something they heard on the radio. I know they do, because I used to be one of them. Chapter 1. The Miracle. There are things in life that you manage to miss. Many dedicated music lovers don't know what a bass guitar is or why every rock band must necessarily include one. A friend of mine has never seen The Godfather, so you can't tell him to take the cannoli and leave the gun and expect him to get the reference. We all have blind spots. Fitness trends, literary illusions, crystal structure, automotive science, nose to tail eating. There's no end to the things that some people have deep knowledge and strong opinions about, but that might, for one reason or another, fail to register on your radar. It could be that nobody ever told you about the bass guitar. Could be that some people are too busy with their doctoral studies or training for marathons or raising three kids to sit down and watch The Godfather. Could be that you just don't care about lattice parameters and waste not, want not culinary trends like eating a whole animal. There's only so much room for particle physics in most brains. Then, whether by accident, by education, or because somebody happens to flick on the lights, all of a sudden you notice that thing that you somehow always managed to miss. In the snap of a finger, you get it. You can see why it matters, and you wonder how you could have been so blind for so long. Was this here the whole time, you ask, thrilled by your discovery? Did everybody know but me? From that moment on, as if your life had been scripted by a screwball screenwriter, you start seeing that once invisible thing everywhere. In your work and in your leisure. In what you read and in the conversations you have with friends. On television and on the internet. That thing you somehow managed to miss all your life starts popping up wherever you look. Sometimes when you see it, you feel a low and glowing pride spouting from your newfound knowledge. You're in the club now, after all, among those who, wink wink, can see what all those dummies somehow still managed to miss. The blindness is the hardest part. For most of the early part of my life, economics was something I did my best to avoid. Whatever it was, and for a long time I didn't really know what it was, economics struck me as the kind of thing that my brain didn't have room for. It sounded like homework to me. It had the whiff of math. I wanted nothing to do with it. I wanted to keep all jibber-jabber about market movements, interest rates, oil futures, home prices, mortgages, tariffs, and trade as far away from my ears as possible. when you really want not.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.